What does it mean to have the right to narrate? This term is usually associated with Edward Said and the Palestinian experience, but it ultimately speaks to a widespread feeling among those who are racialized, those who are gendered, and those who are displaced. It reflects a more generalized need to reclaim something that feels stolen. In this episode, I spoke with Laura Vidal. She's a Paris-based Venezuelan writer and researcher, and she recently wrote an essay in Spanish entitled ¿Quién tiene derecho a contar nuestras historias? Or, who has the right to narrate our stories? Laura and I used to work together at Global Voices. She was the regional editor for Latin America, and I was the regional editor for the Middle East and North Africa. But more importantly, we have been engaging on this question together for several years now. As you'll see, our experiences have some similarities, but they also differ in important ways. So in this episode, we'll be exploring the interrelated topics of identity, displacement, trauma, and the right to narrate. If you like this project, you can now support it on Patreon with a monthly donation. But if you cannot donate, that's also totally fine. One good way to help this project is to just share it with your friends and networks, as well as giving it a review wherever you get your podcast. Thanks again, and I hope you enjoyed this episode. So if we can start with a little bit of introduction, can you tell us a bit about yourself? How did you start thinking about this concept of the right to narrate? Are there episodes in your life that you feel gave this topic, you know, greater urgency? And what does it mean to you to say, I have the right to narrate?
So, I am a Venezuelan, and I've been living in France for the last 10 years. I came here to study, and then there are some changes of plans, I stayed. How did I start to think about this? I think it starts from the point when in my case, it started when I started living in France. And how is it that I automatically lost the right to have an opinion? Because this moment in time that we're living, it happens to be a historical moment for Venezuela as well. In terms of its political life, there's been a long political crisis for the last 20 years, followed by a deep, deep economic crisis that became very, very serious after the 2010. So by the time I was preparing my studies abroad, I wasn't thinking of the economic crisis particularly. Because it wasn't that bad yet, but it was my plan for as long as I can remember to study abroad, to see how the world works outside of Venezuela, the small universe I grew up in. That's part of the reason why I studied languages. That's why I studied English and French. I wanted to have like a big, how to say, you know, like a big number of opportunities to be able to go to or become the people to talk to, and so on. So it was a very conscious, prepared effort, you know, to study abroad, to do things beyond the national context that I grew up in. For many reasons, at some point, certain cultural conventions were too much for me, linked with gender and how it functions in Venezuela, and how the idea of doing something that matters. Also, those are very heavy subjects for me, and they were aspects of my life that brought me a lot of frustration when I was back there. And then when chavismo exploded, that everyone was obsessed about it, and the political conversation kind of kidnapped everything else. And so, you know, things got together a little bit for coincidence, because mine is a story of people that have left the country voting or fleeing or having to find solutions to, you know, to live abroad because they don't have any more food or money or job, and the situation is so dire that they need to find solutions elsewhere. So I'm not saying that doesn't touch me, but it wasn't part of my decision to leave. That doesn't mean, however, that these insatisfactions and these observations about the life of the country didn't stay with me. In fact, they make a big part of my personal struggles, my ways of seeing the world. But at the same time, the moment I live abroad, and I not only live abroad, I live in Paris, you know, and that's a city that has so much narrative and so much imagery. And in Venezuela and in Latin America, there's this big image of Paris. It's like, just by living in Paris, you shouldn't be complaining at all, and you automatically lost any right to say anything about your country. Because, I mean, you're abroad and you're there. So, yeah, it's been a very curious process and a very complicated process. Sometimes it's very difficult to explain. Because it's not like I left when I was 8 or 5 or when I was a child, or I don't remember anything. I left when I was 27, 26 years old. So all my formative years were in Venezuela. It's not even, I haven't even been abroad half of my life yet. So it's sometimes it's confusing when you have people from both sides telling you to shut up for one reason or another. Because at the end, it feels like the point is to make the other shut up.
And so a clear underlying point there, I guess, is that a common phenomenon anyway that I've been seeing is that those who are exiled, displaced, part of the diaspora, so in addition to having to leave their homeland, they usually additionally run the risk of being dismissed because they left their homeland. And I've seen this a lot with obviously with Syrian refugees that I've met in the UK. Not only do they have, you know, what can be called survivor's guilt, like they actually feel guilty that they are no longer in danger because they escaped the horrors of Syria, but they also have to deal with the fact that non-Syrians, and often, well, because they're in the UK, often Westerners, can use that against them, you know, by saying, for example, that they cannot know what's happening right now in Idlib because they are not in Idlib. It's like a form of gaslighting, I think, which inevitably adds to, you know, trauma already experienced. And even worse, and I want to get your take on this or your experience on this, in some of their cases, you know, from some of the stories that I've been hearing, they sometimes even have to deal with pro-Assad Syrians who are in Damascus usually, telling those people who are in exile, who usually come from Aleppo, from the suburbs of Damascus, from the north, from the south, that basically that, you know, they have no right to complain about Syria because they're not physically there. Kind of what you said, well, you're in Paris, you're in London, you're in Istanbul. Why are you complaining about any of this? So how do you navigate these tensions, if you want, in your own context? There isn't, I'm not saying that, you know, there is a right or wrong answer, obviously. I'm just curious about your experience.
To me, very interesting to see the example of Syria as well. Because what I think it's curious is that everyone has something to say but you, or everyone has the right to say something. Is it also depending on the moment in history, especially with this political conflict, when I first arrived to France and started talking to people, like whenever I said it was Venezuelan, I oftentimes I had very enthusiastic people telling me that they really loved the president, that he was a real revolutionary, that oftentimes also from the Arab community here in France, you know, that they might be probably not Palestinians directly, but a lot of them were Tunisian or Algerian or Senegalese, and they are very sensitive to the Palestinian question and the situation in Palestine. And back then, Chavez was extremely vocal about Palestine. I am not sure that Chavez's government was very aware of what was really going on and why, but they were supporting it. So of course, it's always interesting to have a government supporting Palestine's cause, but it sort of gave them this image of, you know, the rebels of the world, the ones that were in favor of those that were oppressed. And to me, it was a lot more complicated than that because, you know, I had the Palestinian thing being thrown at me time and time again, just one example, but the first thing that people will tell me were things about Chavez and how they thought he was great. And whenever I either stay quiet or say that I didn't agree, I was directly being called, you know, just of course, if you're from the high class. And this, not only the idea of how poor and rich people are in Latin America and Venezuela. I'm not saying that it's completely wrong. I don't think that somebody that grows up in this same opportunities to learn another language from an early age, and then being able to go to a public university and get good education and then pass exams, and then having a, you know, the space and the resources to go abroad. I'm going to tell you that nobody with that background can do it, but of course it's not easy, so I understand that image. But at some point, when those images prevail among these people, you know, talking again about the about people in France, not necessarily French, but you know, the people that I used to interact a lot with, they reduce you to a very limited image. And part of the pain of that is that they believe that because you leave a country, nothing ever affects you anymore. It's so wrong. It's so not true. I've been in France 10 years. There's not, I don't think there's a week, a full week in which I don't dream of my hometown, or that I, you know, that I dream of either traumatic, either happy things, but every time taking place in my hometown. And, you know, my parents live in Venezuela. I need to do what I can to help send the money. The situation is really dire. In my family, most of my cousins, and they have left. So that means that most of my uncles and aunts are, who are more or less elderly, they really have to take care of each other. And they don't always have the resources to do so. Even if you have family sending you money from abroad, which makes a huge difference from the rest of the people, there's still shortage of transportation, of food, so that you can have money but no food to buy. And also the situation changes so rapidly that at some point the context is one thing, and then little after it changes, and everyone expects one thing to happen and then something completely different happens. And of course the government is about to leave and crack every 2 years more or less. So it's extremely unstable. It's really unstable. It changes a lot. It's difficult to understand for people inside and outside. And everything that happens during that crisis and before that crisis stays with those who are in and those who are out as well. And I have never thought too deep about the survivor's guilt. But I think it's really true, to the point that I have a hard time talking about it. Whenever I talk about Venezuela, I can't stop. And that makes me think at the same time that, you know, with all the pains that you're carrying, that in my personal case, they're related to the crisis, and they're related to Venezuela itself. Because I can hear over and over again a lot of people being extremely nostalgic of the Venezuela of the 90s and the Venezuela of the 80s, and you know, the time when we had money and the time when Venezuela was quote unquote decent. And I get so demoralized by those comments because, okay, they had this huge buzz, not buzzword, but you know, the sort of very common phrase like, we were happy and we didn't know it. Well, maybe you were happy, but so much of the whole population was so unhappy, which translates to the years that we're living now. You know, together with that, it's also related to women, related to families, related to gender in general. So I hear people that had to leave, that they were not like they chose to leave, but that they had to leave and that they missed that, and then they're capable and willing and even eager to reconstruct that. It's just, my heart breaks double, because if you're going back to that, you're doing nothing. I don't know, I guess it's double. When I left, I was very guilty. I was feeling very, very guilty, and I had the whole plan, because I also left with a scholarship. This is a very important thing in my personal story. And the plan was to finish the PhD and then go back and do the program that I had to do, and then kind of quote unquote pay back, because I don't have to pay back with money, but I should go back and work at least 3 years. And by the time I was done with my PhD, and by the way, I couldn't finish it with the scholarship because it was too hard to finish when they wanted me to. By the time I was ready with the PhD, the country wasn't already cracked. It was the ministry that I was supposed to be working in didn't exist anymore. So, and you see a lot of people literally escaping from the country. And I cannot have the luxury to go back and, you know, it will cut a possibility for my family also to keep receiving money. So there are so many layers of complications here. And then when you have somebody that knows absolutely nothing about it, and they're using their own, say, social and political glasses to read such a complicated conflict, it's really frustrating, because not only they're pushing on the wrong buttons, they're feeding a very truly kind of discussion that goes nowhere. But at the same time, they're telling you to shut up. I mean, I guess my main issue is the idea of, because I don't necessarily disagree with people, let's call them outsiders for the sake of the conversation. I'm not against quote unquote outsiders to tell stories about a place. At some point, I guess I am an outsider too now, according to a lot of people. I'm not necessarily against that. My problem is trying to silence people that have something to say, especially when you don't know much about what's going on. And I guess we're going to the Venezuelan-splaining thing.
Yeah, I was going to say that you coined the term, I mean, you used the term Venezuelan-splaining in your piece. So what is it exactly?
Well, it came from mansplaining, which is this situation in which, I'm not going to talk about mansplaining, but Venezuelan-splaining is having somebody who's not Venezuelan and who knows very little about Venezuela explaining to a Venezuelan what is going on in their own country. I think there's a second part to the phenomenon, that is people that have very little to do with the country being able to point out who are the ones that actually have the moral and the permission to explain things. And so in this second part of the phenomenon, a bunch of people are just illegitimate to speak because they're Venezuelan and Chile, because they're white, because they're English, which shows a really lack of comprehension of what Venezuela is, which is a very mixed country. I'm not saying that Venezuela is a white majority country, because it's not. And I'm not saying that most Venezuelans speak English, because they don't. But to think that that is the formula of privilege understood as they tend to understand it in the West, and particularly in the States, is this, not only it's wrong, but it's very mean. Because at the same time, you are, people that are participating in this are, I don't know, it's a kind of neo-imperialistic way of having opinions, if you will, because you are the one who determines who is right to speak according to your view of a country that you don't know. I think I'm not making much sense, but the thing is that this whole thing doesn't make much sense either.
No, I mean, I do. I think you do make a lot of sense. It just feels that basically that the ideas of, you know, the act of gaslighting, which is sort of telling, for those who don't know, it's kind of like telling someone the things that they are seeing, the things they are thinking, are not valid, are not true, basically. So it's kind of like it's a form. Mm-hmm. It can actually be a form of abuse in some cases. But linked to that. You mentioned that, you know, on some level you can consider yourself an outsider. And I mean, I find that very interesting for, you know, personal reasons. I left Lebanon in 2015 with zero intention of actually leaving. I left, and I remember very clearly the day before leaving, I was with friends, and then I went to my favorite little bookshop. And I was speaking to the guy, and everyone basically knew that my goal was I was going to go to London, do 1 year of masters, and then come back to help the country. It was especially, and I should say this, it was in the context of the protest movement in 2015. So there was a lot of momentum, I guess, yeah, for people to say, well, it's normal if you want to leave because you need to build your skills and so on, but then, you know, you should, if you want to, come back and try and help around and that kind of thing. And that indeed was my intention. What ended up happening was
I mean, to cut a long story short, life happened. You know, just stuff happened that were out of my control. I started to have to take other things into account, like if I do go back, can I make enough money to sustain my family? If I do go back, would it be safe? Because I'm, you know, fairly outspoken on a number of things. You know, a number of things had to be taken into account, and then I just stumbled upon the next steps. Rather than, this is something that I think many people may not understand, and I mean, I wouldn't blame them. I think it's not obvious. It's kind of counterintuitive. Mm-hmm. But it's actually fairly difficult to think that much ahead when you're in a situation like this. And yeah, it does add up, I guess. So to bring me to this question, and you did mention it a bit, like the notion of being quote unquote an outsider or being diaspora. And here I'm speaking specifically about first generations, because I think second generations, you have additional dynamics that come into play. But first generation, you know, kind of growing up in one place and then ending up in another. And it's fairly easy to essentially, I mean, besides a survivor's guilt, which we already spoke about, it's easy to just have imposter syndrome, to just feel that you don't have the cultural right anymore to talk about the place where you grew up, or the place that you call home, or the place that you called home, even, you know. Some people, their divorce with the home country is so bad that they end up rejecting it and denying it, and that's a whole phenomenon in itself. So, I mean, in my case, and I'll be curious to see if this sounds familiar, in the context of Lebanon, there was always, well, I mean, I grew up there and everything, but there was always a sense that I had that there was always something missing. That in the sense that it wasn't anything wrong with Lebanon, although at the time I thought it was, because, you know, teenager rebelling against everything. But it felt that there was something that I was not able to fit. There was something wrong with me. That's what I would tell myself at some point. That, you know, I wasn't Lebanese enough. I wasn't Arab enough. I was too westernized, whatever that means, because I was from an early age very against traditional norms and conservative norms. And so I don't know, or even the fact, ironically, that I wasn't Lebanese enough because I'm part Palestinian, which is usually would say, well, maybe you're more Arab now because you have two Arab nationalities, but then that even complicates things because of my politics. And it just sounds like a whole hot mess, if I want to put it this way. Does that sound familiar at all to you?
very much. With, like, I guess in my case, I will add the layer of being a woman. I recognize now that I don't have the layer of being a person of color, but I definitely have the layer of being a woman there. So being a woman in Venezuela is very hard. Being a woman in almost every country on Earth is complicated. And I cannot stress enough the importance of also thinking of the idea of being a woman of color almost everywhere. But I can identify myself a lot with your experience as well, except for the fact that I wasn't that politically conscious. There are many things happening at the same time when you are building your own identity inside. In such societies, like probably the Latin American, if we're going to generalize a little bit, you know, growing up with, in such societies like Arab and Latin American, that curiously have a lot in common. So I was very moved by some of the writings by Edward Said, precisely because he talks a lot about that, what it is to be out of place everywhere. I did feel out of place in Venezuela, I have to say. I don't know, a lot of my sufferings there were trying hard to be part of it, me with this idea of being out of place. Because I was trying very hard to be part of the status quo. And in terms of gender in Venezuela, what that translates to, at least in my experience, is this enormous effort that is expensive, that is physically painful, that is difficult, that it and it takes a lot of time to become an object. Because at the end, you're lookable and you're part of conversations or you're part of some sort of social dynamic the moment you become an acceptable object as a woman. As a subject, I don't think that was something that I was consciously aware of, you know. It was with time also that I realized, you know, all of this effort to be able to become visible and to be able to connect with others takes it being an object. So all this effort is not even to, you know, be a person, a human being talking to other people. And then when I will talk about these things, I, you know, oh, you're so dramatic and this is just not true. And
so whenever,
you know, other kinds of, I guess, gaslighting and being out of place that have to do a lot with gender. And that definitely is shared, I'm very sure, by a huge amount of people, of women and non-male folks, anyway. But I didn't have contact with them. I think it's also important to say that I talk a lot about Venezuela, but I grew up in a town called Maracay. And that is the community and the society that, you know, where I felt a lot of quite out of place. I still want to say that there are circles and communities that I didn't know back then that were open to, you know, to respect the individuality of people and the difference and so on. But in the urban areas of the center north, which is where I grew up and where my family comes from, that was extremely difficult. And then what happened is also that I left the country and I realized a lot of the violence that was living because it stopped. I wasn't aware, for example, that media and publicity were so aggressive, so violent, and so dehumanizing towards women. I honestly didn't know. I guess I will protest a couple of times and say, look at that, because, you know, you grow up surrounded by images of women that are half naked, holding beer, and oftentimes they don't even have a head. I honestly didn't, I saw there was a problem. I knew that wasn't okay, but it was so much, you know, it was the water, you know, it's this idea of the fish not seeing the water. Kind of, I guess, I saw it a little, but also observing that too much would mean that I was going to be, again, out of place. And so, anyways, whatever I did, I still was out of place in one way or another. And so when I left, I realized that a lot of things I was going through were actually different kinds of violence. And being able to, you know, very simple things, you know, it's not only the wonderful experience of living in Paris, which I won't deny is actually quite nice, and having access to so many cultural products and communities of people coming from all kinds of places, and that was wonderful. But there was something that was extremely stupid that was also available for me when I started my studies, and it was having a computer of my own with a free connection to the internet and being able to speak French and English as well as Spanish. That made an incredible difference. Sometimes it makes me laugh, but it's actually true. And you know, I guess a little bit like this idea, this Virginia Woolf's room of one's own. I think it's, you know, having a computer of one's own is also, it's very important. You know, that was the vehicle that let me, you know, that opened the door to other struggles of other people, the stories of people that I didn't know that were like me, that didn't necessarily live in the same places as me. I also, funnily enough, connected with a lot of Venezuelans and Venezuelan feminists that were doing really nice work and thinking together and creating community through the networks. And I just didn't know them because I wasn't connected to them. And then from the point of view of identity, what it means to be Latin American, what it means to be Venezuelan, that is also, those are also huge questions that at some point to me, they're also a little bit of emotional blackmail. Because there's always somebody who feels very comfortable in the community trying to, you know, force you to be or say certain things to be the person, this is, you know, making friends in Paris is one of the most difficult things ever. But at the same time, it's difficult for me sometimes to exchange with the community of Venezuelans in Paris. I kind of got lost with what I was going to with all of this.
Well, you were kind of leaning towards talking about this anyway, but like you write in your piece that you've never studied Latin America as much as you did when you moved to Europe, and this is very funny when I read this, because that's, I mean, I'm literally studying Lebanon on my PhD now, and that's something that I never thought I would be doing when I actually left it, you know, supposedly temporarily, to just do my master's for 1 year and come back. My master's had nothing to do with Lebanon. It was just general cultural studies and trying to kind of absorbing as many world cultures, if you want, as you can, except Lebanon, because like I told myself, on some subconscious level, like, obviously, there's no need to study it in that sense. You know, I know it. I'm it. You know, I grew up there. It's, you know, it's part of me.
Yeah.
But do you think sometimes we just need to, you know, I don't know if that sounds cheesy, but like, you know, to take a step back, to see things differently. Like, in other words, how does one balance out the very real and painful feeling that, you know, we mentioned that is called survivor's guilt and even imposter syndrome? How is that balanced out with one's mental health? Like, at the end of the day, when we say things like, I'm now an outsider, that it's a relational definition. You're only an outsider because there are insiders. And so if I'm an outsider, I'm not asking you to answer for me, of course, I'm just thinking out loud. But like, if I'm an outsider when it comes to Lebanon, what would it take to become an insider again? You know, like, and has there ever been a time when I would be considered an insider? Because even if I think again of my example, even before 2015, I was writing about Lebanon, you know, blogging and stuff on a local level, but it never had any kind of impact that can be compared to, I'm talking in terms of scale, to, you know, people with resources already. And these people tend to be transnational. They kind of move in between places anyway. Even they may be non-Lebanese, but just, you know, work for a big Western newspaper in Lebanon or Al Jazeera or any of those. And their positionality, if you want, would rarely be questioned. And I feel that it's those who ironically end up being questioned with these accusations of, you know, being an outsider or not being well-placed enough to think about these things anymore, and you're no longer there, and, you know, everything that we just spoke about now, those people end up being the ones thinking about these things that they're being accused of the most.
that's a funny way of looking at it. It's a bit, when you were talking, there was one thing that came to my mind. Like, I guess we tend to have this anxiety and I tend to call myself an outsider also, because I listen to the ones that are trying to silence people like us. So at some point, this is the kind of acknowledgement and acceptance of their discourse, which is not necessarily more valid than the discourse that you can have about yourself. So at some point, there's a sort of struggle. Of course, you listen, and of course, you take that into account, because definitely my experience is not going to be the same one as somebody who's still living and breathing the crisis inside of Venezuela. But at some point, we are all insiders and outsiders of some sort of circle. And sometimes I have a feeling that the conditions change according to the person who's accusing you or inviting you in. It's very tricky to say, this is the circle, and these are the people, and these are the subjects, and here are the questions. It's funny because at the end, it feels like it's always the same people, the ones that are allowed to talk or allowed to you know, choose where the real voices. That's one part of it. At the same time, I think that one of the reasons why we are friends, you and I, and that we've been able to connect so well, is that I think that we also make part of the kind of people that I think that they exist all over the world, that they sort of are born, I guess, with their belly button pointing, outside wherever they're at. So it feels like it's only natural that when you are in your native country, you're looking at the rest of the world with a lot of curiosity. And then once you leave it and you are somewhere else, you go back and you look at where you came from. I suppose you always have to look somewhere else. People make it complicated, extra complicated. It's already complicated. I'm thinking, for example, of my field advisor, because he has very free opinions about what I should know and what we should talk about. And you know, at some point, I remember that she was making fun of me because I didn't know, you know, after the attacks in Paris in 2015, after those attacks, there was this concert. I never remember the name of the group that was playing. I think it was the Angels of Death Metal. Mm. I don't remember. The Sevenfold of Death Metal. But the thing is that they were having a show again. And she's standing, you know, with a lot of excitement. Did you see that the Angels of Death Metal were coming back? And I was like, no, I didn't know. And then she was like, you know, not only you should be aware of the news from Latin America, you should be aware of the news here in France as well. And then, okay, wait a second. I'm aware of the news in France, I'm aware of the news in Latin America, and I'm aware of the news internationally in the world. Is this, at some point it feels like whenever you move, people tend to have different demands, and they demand you to know different things. And not only they demand you to know different things, when you come from a place that has a catchy, sexy kind of prizes, they also demand explanations, easy explanations, short explanations. It feels like the thing is that it's the notion of privilege here is also very important, because at some point I have never accused my thesis advisor of not being informed enough of what's going on in the world. Mm. Like, you should know what is going on in whatever. Oh, but, you know, she's French living in France, and she's the one with power, so I'm the one who should actually explain to her very well whatever is going on in my country, so she doesn't get bored 10 seconds after I started talking. And at the same time, I should be aware of whatever is happening internationally, and of course in France, because so many things happen here. So it has to do with the demands that people have according to what they think you should be. And I think it also pushes us to think about identity and how identity is made of things that you choose and things that are chosen by other people for you. Mm-hmm. And dealing with those at the same time in discussions and in political discussions can be very difficult.
One thing that I thought about when I was reading your piece is that there seems to me, anyway, like, let's say in my experience and some experiences that I've become more familiar with, that the question of do you ever think of going back, it's a question that is either asked explicitly, like in those terms, which happened just a few days ago, not necessarily in an ill meaning way, you know, it's not necessarily that you should go back. It's more that the question is asked sometimes, and trying to speak specifically of those few cases, of those specific circumstances, which makes you sometimes feel like you're not where you're supposed to be, and which sort of obviously reinforces imposter syndrome and survivor's guilt and all of these things again. And I just wonder, I'll give a more specific example, since it happened a few days ago. A friend asked me that question, do you ever think of going back? And the question was sort of, the undertone of it in the conversation was, you know, things are bad over there, you should probably use your skills or use your whatever people think that I have to go and help. And that was the undertone. It kind of even, it came out in more explicit terms after. No ill intention were meant by this, but my response when we spoke about this was, do you realize that It's you're asking me to solve a crisis that I've been already trying to tackle while I was there, and that it is forcing people like me out because, at least for the present, for the near future, we feel that we've lost the tools to actually do anything about it, or if we didn't have the tools in our case at all, and we're trying to build alternatives, and we've become very aware that those alternatives take a long time, and in the meantime there are basic survival questions that have to be answered, and I have not been able to answer them while I was there. She thought about this. Conversation went well. There was no tension or anything like that. But I just felt that she did not get it. Like, I was not able to get my point across, if you want to put it that way. Although I don't know if that's how I would put it. But I was simply not able to express myself. And I think that 5 years in, it's 4 years and a half now since leaving. Although I do go back quite a lot. I still have not been able to answer that question, because I'm still in the phase where most of my friends, those I grew up with or those I met when I was at university in Beirut, are themselves in the process of either leaving or have already left. And we're kind of like, you know, you think about it as a different stages, and someone is at like stage number 4 and other people are in stage number 2, and we're trying to help each other out, get to the next stage or whatever it is. And in this context, it's very difficult to answer the question, do you ever think of going back? Because my answer would be, I think about it all the time. But whether I can go back, whether it would make sense for me to go back other than just to visit, that's not just a matter of do you ever think of going back, because, you know, the answer to that question is yes. And do you want to go back? The answer to that question is like sometimes yes, sometimes no. Very conflicted.
Yeah.
And no, it's it's can you go back?
Yeah. Are you safe when you're back? Can you help in the same way once you're back? I think that sometimes when I get that question, definitely I think about going back every day. But I guess it's part of what feeds my guilt. It's also that I want to go back to pay my debt. Because at some point, you help when you have a certain amount of resources. And sometimes I feel that I was so overwhelmed by so many things when I was back there. And I was not even close to the people that suffered the most in Venezuela. You know, I still had a family, and I guess I could go to university. You know, there are a lot of questions of privilege that I am extremely grateful for. But I was still quite overwhelmed. The only moment where I could, you know, gather the strength and the time and the resources to be able to read and understand the political conflict was when I was out. And this goes back to what we were saying before, you know, once you're out, there's a sort of silence that's maybe what about it, silence in the sense that kind of the noise that's so present when you are there stops and you're able to think for a moment without the noise and without the trauma and without the fear. Some of the context in which I felt that I was constantly questioned was when I was editing for Google Voices. A couple of times I was told, this job will be a lot better if you will be in Latin America. And at some point I said, yeah, but I'm not the one writing. I think that the pain of not being in the community anymore was part of the text. Because it's a kind of wound that I haven't been able to heal completely. And at the same time, there's also this game of legitimacy that I think it's kind of poisonous. When others are trying to talk about your place of origin when there's a conflict, you're not trying to silence somebody else. You're trying to add more perspectives, things that you realize. same few, as you said before, and I don't think it was cheesy at all, seems to take a step back. And I was very happy to see that in a conversation with the two super famous bloggers in Venezuela, we're talking to a psychologist who's specializing on the trauma of this, you know, growing diaspora. And one of the things that she explained is that you need to cut people from slack, because a lot of people that are leaving, they didn't want to leave because they were very angry. For context, they were kind of angry. You know, there's people that leave the country and then they start having like a billion opinions and knowing what to do and what not to do. Yeah, but at some point when you are in the country and you have to queue for hours to be able to buy milk, when you don't know where your next meal is going to come from, when you don't know what's going to happen with your parents because they're elderly and there are no, you know, medical services, and when you see that your money worth less and less, and then you see that another political crisis is looming, and then everything is, you know, there's a big circus distracting everyone, but at the same time, it's not only the circus, it's the daily life. Everything is extremely complicated. Going from one point of one city to another is super complicated. Doing the, you know, there are so many things that are blocked. Internet works so bad, and sometimes there are just blackouts, information blackout, and then connection blackout. The most basic things are very difficult to do. And of course, at that point, how it is that you're going to discuss the political future of your country? Once you're out, so there are a couple of basic things that are covered, your brain starts thinking about that again. And I think that taking away the right of those people to speak is very cruel. And in this, I'm not talking about myself necessarily, but, you know, there's a growing diaspora. So I think that a lot of people that were actually telling others to shut up, I guess I like to think that a lot of them are living now and understanding what it is to, and realizing this. And so I think that what comes to mind also is I'm thinking of Chimamanda Adichie. When she talks about stories, you know, stories matter, and many stories matter. And in the context of terrible conflicts like that of Syria, the complications of Lebanon, the complications of Venezuela, you can have one person telling you what it is all about. And I don't think there's any country that can tell you only one story or one person can explain you one thing. It's just not possible. And in the case of Venezuela, politically, I don't know, it's just that the conflict makes fun of all the categories that are usually used to analyze a conflict. And it became this thing about East and West and imperialist ideas against socialism. There are so many things that get tags that are not enough. And the refusal of so many people to accept that you cannot put one box here, it's just not possible. There are many things happening at the same time. No, you cannot learn about this conflict in 10 minutes. You cannot. And it's ironic because at the same time, you have all these things and all these people telling others to shut up. But in my personal experience, the second I tell someone that I'm Venezuelan, everyone wants me to explain to them what it is that is going on, if the media is lying, if all the exaggerations, if my parents are there. Everyone wants to talk about the crisis every time. I am reduced to being Venezuelan half of my time. And, you know, it was funny because a couple of weeks ago, I went to a meeting of teachers. I teach languages for a living. And it was a lovely meeting with a lot of people from a lot of places. And then there's this gentleman approaching me. And then he's like, okay, you know, how are you? And what are you teaching? And so on. And then, okay, I'm Venezuelan. And he started, you know, his eyes get so bright. Like, oh, she's the one who's going to tell me. Oh, she's the one who's going to explain. And then I said, well, are you going to ask me about the political conflict? And he's like, no, but is the media being okay? So we started talking about that. I started explaining. And he said, you see, it's complicated quite a lot. Well, because it is. And then at some point, you know, I finally could pause a little and, where are you from? Oh, well, I'm from the United Kingdom. And I said, well, I'm guessing you don't want to talk about Brexit, do you? And he's like, oh, no, please, I don't want to talk about Brexit. And so how does this work? I am the continuous ambassador of Venezuela and the continuous political analyst, but at the same time, I don't have the right to analyze, but at the same time, it should be short. I guess it's at some point too much communication breaks communication too.
Yeah. Do you feel that, I don't know, there may be some dimension that we were not able, some question that we were not able to address, or some, you know, topic that could have been delved in a bit deeper or something?
Yeah, like a million. I feel that with this subject, I don't know, because I guess one of the results of this is that I don't authorize myself to talk about it too much.
Mm.
So whenever I start talking about it, I feel that I go everywhere and that I am not super coherent. Yet I'm super interested and I want to talk about it, but it's scary. I'm a little afraid of being incoherent.
Mm.
I'm not sure that I kind of expressed a lot of complexities of
Well, I mean, from my point of view, you know, as the listener here, if you want, I do think you've expressed it quite well. I think that those questions that are very difficult to answer are difficult to answer for a reason, and so it would be very difficult to be quote unquote more coherent, if that makes sense. I think that especially when we're trying to, you know, which we try to do a bit, but try and not necessarily compare different experiences, but just find what are some of the commonalities, where are the echoes, and why are there experiences that that echo one another, to not say that they are the same, because I don't think that two experiences are ever the same. But I think that, I hope anyway, that like the conversation that we've had so far would be beneficial to those who will find similarities, and, you know, to those who don't necessarily relate. I don't think that there is, you know, a one size fits all answer to this. So like I do believe that the conversation is what it is, and I feel like this is why it's important, and this is why it's good.
Well, there's a couple of things that I would like to say.
Mm-hmm.
This conversation is complicated, of course, but this complication is not necessarily about people outside of their countries in conflict. This conversation is about identity. This conversation is about inequality. And this is a conversation about global citizens, and I'm using big quotation marks. To me, it was extremely interesting when you use the example of somebody asking you if you're thinking of going back. Also because they don't take into account this idea of love-hate for your own country,
mm-hmm.
and how you are educated to think about a country as something that you should love, and a place where people are a certain way and not any other way. And also, I think there's a generational aspect here, because I am not very sure that, the Italian communities that were all around the Americas when they were having this terrible crisis that they had, or Europeans after the war in general, you know, Spaniards after the Spanish Civil War, I'm not sure to what extent they were either exploring the world or the witches trying to survive. And most of them were dreaming to go back. Curiously enough, there's a huge amount of Italian, Spanish, and a lot of people in Venezuela that migrated during their crisis, and they stayed in Venezuela, and they're not living in Venezuela in spite of the crisis today. It's their children and their grandchildren that are taking advantage of the blue passports to be able to go. But they're staying. They're in, quote-unquote, their country, and they don't want to change. And so there are many, many questions in terms of migration It's very interesting that for somebody, I guess, somebody like us in this age and this interest, it feels negative to say, only have Latin American friends or only Venezuelan friends. You should have French friends and you can learn the language well, so you can, you know, integrate well, because it's also the discourse that it's always around.
Mm-hmm.
But that isn't necessarily the mentality of a lot of communities, that for survival, they need to stay together. And also because melting around and integrating is extremely difficult in countries like this. I think these questions are very relevant to a certain amount of people, but some other groups and communities of people don't even have the time or the energy to think about that. And they're still, I guess, this is demanded to be a representation of their countries and their prizes nonetheless. So this has a lot to do with the privileges that we have, with the stories that we can tell, with and also to a certain extent to the willingness we have to keep talking. Because I guess in my personal case, I should have shut up because other people tell me to. You know, I'm Venezuelan and I went through this and I have these things and I know these things and I studied these things. And I'm not going to shut up because I'm abroad. And yes, I do have to acknowledge a lot of privilege,
mm-hmm.
but at the same time, it's the one that is making me able to speak to other people and to be able to build bridges with people that want generally to understand what is going on. But yeah, I guess part of the lesson here is, you know, you should certainly be mindful of the privileges that are making you biased, and the same privileges that are making your story incomplete. But that doesn't mean you should shut up. I mean, that doesn't mean you should be silent. I guess the question is balance. I guess, at least for the moment, that's more or less what I can think of.
I think that these conversations aren't really meant to answer much. they pose more questions. And I think that the conversations like the one we just had just allow us to reframe questions, I think, a bit more accurately. To give them more nuance, especially in contexts that are, for lack of a better word, contentious. You know, that there's tension there. There's something that is not resolved because of a multiplicity of factors that simple questions simply are not fit for purpose. They are not able to actually tackle. It doesn't make much sense, you know, since you mentioned it before, to just speak about the situation in Venezuela as left-wingers versus right-wingers. It doesn't make much sense to go in Lebanon and to think that it's just a matter of bringing everyone together. And, you know, that's, what does that even mean? You know, that it's a complicated situation. And just to stick to Lebanon for a sec, since, you know, that's what I'm more comfortable talking about directly. When I get asked the question, the last one that we spoke about, like, do you ever think of going back? I always wonder whether it's that question that kind of separates me from people that I'm not able to relate with. Not able to relate with on this question, not on everything. Because, you know, theoretically, you can connect with everyone. And I think that part of it is luck, in the sense that I was born in 1991, the war ended in 1990. That is a coincidence, you know, like, it's something that obviously I didn't think much when I was born. So,
absolutely.
Me being part of the post-war generation is in some ways an imposed identity. And that is a reality that I feel many of us back home and in exile or in diaspora or as migrants or whichever, you know, displaced, whichever terms people prefer using. I'm not one to choose for anyone. We've slowly started realizing, and again, from conversations with friends, we started slowly realizing that a lot of what's happening, a lot of what we have been going through are sort of the consequences of things that happened even before we were born, or when we were very young, and thus couldn't do much about it, basically, is the point. So it's one thing to want to change things, and I do, I really hope people don't misinterpret this as me saying don't change things or whatever, but I'm basically just emphasizing, I guess, and you know, this is the result of years and years of self-doubt and asking myself this question, and I'm sure there'll be many more years to come of me asking that same question. Be kind to yourself, I guess, is the conclusion, because you're dealing with a lot. Try and understand what these things are, why do they affect you the way they do, and maybe with that you would be better equipped to help others. And I think that's sort of the paradox, because the immediate instinct that I had and that many people that I know also have is that it doesn't really matter whether you are personally, mentally stable or not, just go there, be of physical use or whatever. That did happen to me. I tried that, literally, you know, that experience and everything. At some point, I was just actually more of a problem to my friends and family back home, because I was just too much to deal with, and I was too much to deal with myself. And I had to just find a balance that for now makes sense. It may not make sense forever. It may change, you know, at the end of the year, next year, I don't know. But that's what makes sense for now. Yeah. And that's what I personally need to accept, in a sense.
Yeah, I think that the point of being kind to oneself is very important. And I guess it's the first step to be kind with others. Because I was crazy insensitive before. I will never forget having like one of our friends from Google Voices. I will always be teasing him because, you know, he says, I don't think he will be listening to the podcast. You know, remember that I was always teasing Eddie Avila, like, you're not a real Bolivian, because he grew up in the United States. Who am I to say where he's from or not? And because karma is a bitch, Venezuelan-splaining happened. And then I was thinking, like, who was I to tell him, like, you're real, not a real, shut up, woman, really? And I don't know, I don't think he even remembers, I don't know. But it's this idea of trying to impose people their countries or their cultures. And there's this guy that I really like, and if you guys and visitors in the world of, well, in my area, you know, in education and learning, and he talks about intercultural impostures. You want people from one place to be a certain way, period. So you're not giving others the privilege and the possibility and frankly, the reality of being a mishmash of many, many things. We are able to talk and exchange and share because there are, you know, for better or worse, one of the things that connects us is a kind of imperialistic language that we are learning because it's the language of business power, and if you want to do things, you better speak English. Mm-hmm. If you spoke Arabic and I spoke Spanish, this friendship will be doomed.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there are things going on that are very easy to tag, and it's very easy to try to tag people because at some point that gives you peace. Like, oh, the world is not that chaotic. I'm sorry, but it is. And it will always be, and we might not be in peace with it. And you cannot... Domesticating people through what you think their countries are or should be is always going to, I don't know, it's going to give you a very incomplete story, and it's very likely to make it be very... unfair.
Yeah.
I have been oftentimes.
I quite agree with that. Thank you a lot for this conversation, and I hope
thank you a lot for inviting me.
My pleasure. I really hope that we'll just do more of these as well in the future.
Well, I think that I'm going to keep talking about this for the rest of the evening.